Welcome to TV, Tennessee Valley Church. This week we're at Huntsville's Botanical Gardens, a spectacular spring spot to speak about Easter. Easter, of course, is the celebration that Jesus was crucified on a Friday and alive again on Sunday morning. Today I want to focus on one of the ladies who went to the tomb that first Easter morning. In fact, the central figure in the Easter story, other than Jesus, of course. I'm talking about Mary Magdalene, or Mary from the town of Magdala. Some people think Mary Magdalene is the prostitute described in Luke 7 who, having experienced forgiveness and redemption from Jesus, poured perfume on his feet and washed his feet with her hair out of profound gratitude. But we don't know that was her. We for sure meet Mary Magdalene in Luke chapter 8, where she's one of the women who supported Jesus and his disciples financially. Now, support didn't mean to Jesus what it means to some mega TV Christian personalities today who, you know, fly in private jets and live in mansions fit for movie stars. Jesus sometimes didn't even have a place to lay his head. But he and his followers did have food to eat. And that was largely because of a circle of women who kept Jesus and his band of disciples going. Mary Magdalene was part of that circle. We also know that when Jesus met her, Mary Magdalene was a hot mess. Luke 8:2 says, Mary had seven demons cast out of her by Jesus. Now, we could spend an interesting portion of this program wondering about Mary Magdalene's seven demons. I do believe in the demonic and that Jesus battled literal demons. I also know that the first century mindset equated mental illness and epilepsy with demons. So, all I know for sure is that Mary's life had gone off the rails when she met Jesus, and he transformed her. Mary Magdalene was among a handful of ladies who left their homes in the cool of the first Easter morning and walked to the garden where the tomb was in which Jesus' body had been buried. The ladies' intention was to pay their further respects for Jesus by rubbing perfume and oil on the wrappings of his body. But what the women found when they arrived was rather odd. The guards weren't guarding anymore. The tomb wasn't tombing anymore. The seal wasn't sealing anymore. The dead wasn't dead anymore. So many things happened so fast at this point in the story, the details get a little confusing. But we know that after everyone else had come and gone from the empty tomb, Mary Magdalene remained there alone. Mary Magdalene is one of the most intriguing characters in all the Bible. According to the novel, The Da Vinci Code, Jesus married Mary Magdalene and they had children. In the movie, The Last Temptation of Christ, Jesus was tempted by Mary Magdalene. In Jesus Christ Superstar, Mary Magdalene falls in love with Jesus and sings the popular song, I Don't Know How to Love Him. Now, of course, those are fictitious, fabricated stories. But that kind of story about Mary Magdalene springs up from time to time because she's such an intriguing character, one of the most fascinating characters in all the Bible. Again, we know from Luke 8 that she was once haunted by seven demons and Jesus radically changed her life. And again, we know that Mary Magdalene was among those who went that Sunday morning to Jesus' empty tomb and that eventually everyone left except Mary Magdalene who remained. She sat there pensively, not knowing whether Jesus was alive or dead. And when Jesus showed up, she didn't recognize him. She didn't realize who it was at first. A distraught Mary, a frightened, confused Mary Magdalene who didn't expect to see Jesus at all, didn't recognize him immediately. When Mary Magdalene did recognize Jesus, she embraced him. In fact, she grabbed him such that Jesus had to smile and say something like, not so tight. Mary Magdalene knew what it was to be rescued from a sad life. She knew what it was like to live with demons haunting her. She also knew what it was like to be redeemed. And the one who redeemed her was alive and standing right there before her. And she could not contain her emotion. Mary Magdalene is the central figure in the Easter story. And that is not by accident. It is not a random thing that God gave the primary role of announcing Jesus' resurrection to Mary Magdalene, a woman whose past was imperfect. For the story we celebrate on Easter, it's the story of both resurrection and redemption. I read the following from a lady named Christina, who was haunted by the shame of a difficult past and a dysfunctional family of origin. She said, "God has written me into His story of redemption, where I have joined an assembly of other broken, sinful people." I love that line. God has written me into His story of redemption. God wrote Christina and Mary Magdalene into His story of redemption. And in just a few minutes, I'm going to tell you the story of someone else God wrote into His story of redemption. It is my favorite story.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I have tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, You are glory.
Welcome to Botanical Garden. We're joined today by Executive Director of the Huntsville Sports Commission, Mark Russell. Thanks for joining us today.
Lisa, I'm glad to be here with you.
A lot of people recognize you, Mark, from City Council, Huntsville City Council, for a long time.
Yes.
But now working with the Sports Commission, you probably enjoy this a little bit more?
Yes, it's definitely a lot better. Hardly anybody complains about sports.
We just wrapped up the weekend where we had the U.S. Paracycling races here. How did that go?
Lisa, it went great. If you've ever been to a paracycling event, it's so uplifting. All the athletes are overcoming disabilities and challenges, and they give it their all, and it's you'll never have a bad day after you go to one of their events.
Sports can fit into so many of Travis's messages, I've realized. And today he's talking about redemption and being redeemed, and that fits in with sports because, you know, if an athlete's not quite as good as they want to be, they can work and get better and better.
Sure. That's the great thing about athletics. We compete, but we also compete against ourselves. So we're competing against a team, but we're trying to do better for ourselves. So like you know, the cross-country races.
With the boys.
You try to get a personal record, and sometimes you may come in 25th. But you did better than you did before, and you can enjoy that.
And try to be better the next season.
Absolutely.
We also mentioned just the friendships that have been made through sports, because you mentioned Mayfair Park. In my days with the boys at Mayfair Park, those women, those ladies, those moms I met, were still good friends.
Right. We say sports builds community, and certainly it does in Huntsville. We make a lot of our friends from the parks, whether they're competing in baseball, softball, whatever the sport would be. That's generally where you make your social relationships. And like you, I miss those days. Sometimes I go to Mayfair Park just to get a Coke and watch the little kids play.
Guys play.
Yeah. You know, obviously I go to Huntsville High games and Grissom games and anything to see other people. And I think sports in our neighborhoods, that's where we go hang out at the neighborhood parks or the basketball gyms. And so it definitely builds community. And if you think about it, you have a lot of friends from your children's sports or your own sports, your own teammates.
Sports tourism is so important to Huntsville and the Tennessee Valley. It brings in a lot of money, a lot of revenue.
It sure does, and sports tourism is the number one, well, probably the number one mission of the Huntsville Sports Commission. We, with the sports tourism team, the Convention Visitors Bureau, the Von Braun Center, downtown Huntsville, so many of us are trying to bring in events so that the taxpayers really, really benefit from this. If the people come into town, spend the night in our hotels and eat in our restaurants, it helps all of us. And so we spend a lot of time trying to get people to come into Huntsville and enjoy their stay.
And some of the sports that the Sports Commission works to bring in are sports we may not think about, not typically just football, baseball, but
that's
different
correct.
Sports.
When I mention sports, people think football, basketball, baseball, but we spend most of our time doing other things. Recently, we had a curling event, and if you had asked me if I'd ever be involved in a curling event, I said there's absolutely no way, but we have a wonderful ice sports center here in Huntsville, and we had a great curling event, just like in the Olympics, and it was really fun.
And what are we looking for the rest of 22?
Well, we have, you may not know it, but we have one of the best inland beach volleyball complexes in all of the South and maybe in the United States. Beach volleyball is growing rapidly, but it's mainly growing in Florida, the Gulf Coast, the West Coast, and we're trying to get it to grow inland. And so we're having three college beach volleyball tournaments at the end of the month. There'll be two weekends, and some of the best teams in the nation will be here. Florida State, LSU, and Texas Christian University, TCU, are all ranked in the top five in beach volleyball, and they'll be in Huntsville, Alabama.
Well, we'll put up the website so people will see the dates and times and can come out and watch.
Absolutely. You can go to the Huntsville Sports, huntsvillesports.com. Our website has every event. Most all our events are free, and we want people to attend, and we want people to stop in and see what we're doing.
And I think I've seen on somebody's Facebook page, maybe Bubba Roby, you in the football jersey from Huntsville High School.
Yes, I'm a big gear guy. I like all the stuff, and everybody likes to give me hats and jerseys to wear, but that was actually my Huntsville High jersey. Still sort of fits.
Well, thanks a lot, Mark.
Yeah, I love, y'all love the TV church, and obviously love my referee friend, Travis.
Oh, thanks for joining us. He loves you, too.
Okay.
That's what I was hoping for.
Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Mary Magdalene, the central figure in the Easter morning story, other than Jesus, was a hot mess when Jesus met her and changed her life. It's not just a random thing that God gave the primary role of announcing Jesus' resurrection to Mary Magdalene, for the story we celebrate on Easter is a story of both resurrection and redemption. Now, here's my favorite story. About 1946, not very far from here on Sand Mountain, a man and wife had a son, age 14, and a daughter, age 11. The man, the husband and father, already had lived a rough life. He had left school after the sixth grade and had fought and partied his way across the South during the Great Depression. He had a gold tooth where, he explained to me many years later, the original had gotten knocked out in a fight. That married man met another woman at work. They became romantically involved and, well, he ran off with her, abandoned his wife and his kids. He sent a little money back to help support his son and daughter, but not much. His wife and children were devastated. The man, named J.D., and the woman he'd met, named Maud, were married and moved to Anniston. Within a couple of years, their marriage already was in trouble. Maud loved J.D., but found it hard to live with him. He had a good heart, but he also had a foul mouth, crude manners, and he drank too much. Somewhere around 1950, a church in Anniston decided to hold what they called a tent revival. So the church rented a vacant lot downtown, put up a carnival-like tent, invited a traveling evangelist, and planned a series of services. Then, somebody in that church that was holding a tent revival invited J.D. to a service. Now, he admitted to me, he had not been to a church except, he said, for maybe a funeral or a wedding. But since his friend invited him, and since going to a tent wasn't exactly like going to a church, J.D. considered it. When J.D. mentioned it to his wife, Maud, she thought it couldn't hurt. So they went, and something happened. That fire-breathing, pulpit-pounding, Bible-waving preacher spoke of sin and salvation in language that grabbed J.D. by the heart and wouldn't let him go. So J.D. and Maud kept going back night after night. And then after the service one night, J.D. just couldn't sleep. In the middle of the night, he called Bartow, his brother-in-law, who was a pastor. Bartow got dressed and drove from Oxford to Maud and J.D.'s house in Anniston. That pastor, with big hands and broad shoulders and a tender heart, explained what it means to be transformed, saved, reborn, to become a follower of Jesus. They knelt in the living room of 200 East 30th Street, and J.D. threw himself on the mercy of God. He prayed through his tears for God to forgive him and change his life. God answered his simple prayer, and J.D. became a moral, ethical, loving, devoted follower of Jesus. He was radically changed. Those who knew J.D. in the last several decades of his life, as I did, knew him to be a very different man than the one who had abandoned his family. He was committed to Maud, his wife, and was a faithful follower of Jesus. He served in all kinds of roles at his church and wore out at least two copies of the Bible, reading it and marking in it and understanding it as best he could. Now, here's why that's my favorite story. The big strapping pastor who drove over in the middle of the night and prayed with J.D. was Bartow Mason, my uncle. J.D., the man with the rough history whose life was transformed, was my father. Maud was my mom. That tent revival was 9 or 10 years before I was born. Now, I know God can do anything, but it's sobering to think of who, what, or where I'd be, and even if I'd be, had my father not had that life-transforming experience. Let me be clear. There are consequences to sinful choices. My father bore the weight of regret until he reached heaven, and God wiped his tears away. Redemption, such as my father experienced, does not mean the alleviation of consequences. Redemption is simply God's act of restorative love that makes something beautiful out of our biggest failures. My father's story is why my favorite word is grace. It's why I'm not willing to give up on anyone. And frankly, it's one reason I love doing TV Church. Every week, my hope and prayer is that this program will be for someone what that tent revival was for my father. It is not by coincidence that Mary Magdalene is the central figure that first Easter Sunday morning. Mary Magdalene would tell you, Easter is the story of both resurrection and redemption.
Thank you for joining us today. If you are new to TV Church, I'm John Lemons, the minister to young adults. That would be those ages 18 to 39.
And I'm Kristen Prasad, minister to kids and families here at First Baptist Huntsville. Today is a day of celebration. Happy Easter to you, wherever you're joining us from, right down the street or further away. Know that we consider you part of our extended church family, and we pray that this half hour has been a blessing to you. As church at the heart of the city with a heart for the region, we want you to know that there are opportunities for you to engage beyond TV Church.
The best way to learn more about First Baptist and the ways to engage in person and remotely is to visit our website, tvchurch.online. There you can hit the Contact Us button on the left-hand side to start that process. You can also connect with our online community, submit prayer requests, watch more episodes, and find other helpful resources.
We'd love to get to know you better, so reach out today. Well, we've just heard another inspiring message from Travis. If it has made an impact on you, please share it with others. You can do that by email or text or through one of your social media platforms.
Let's close with these words of benediction. Living God, long ago, faithful women proclaimed the good news of Jesus' resurrection, and the world was changed forever. Teach us to keep faith with them, that our witness may be as bold, our love as deep, and our faith as true. Amen.
Yep, I'm still rolling.
All right, Travis, back up a little bit.
Have him back up a little bit more.
A little bit more.
Just a little bit more.
Do one big step more.